bulletproof.
Guy, you are going to shoot the Indian man. Guy, you are going to shoot the
Indian.
Ningeingia kwa mtaro au something ama ningeharibu majani. Si ndio ukaa hizo. Lakini damu huwa tu kiasi kiasi. Unajua most times zinaanza kutolewa nje. Unaweza kutana na hizo but most times za accident pia ndani. Hapa kwenye mtu ambaye ndio damu kwa
at 1934 hours, the deceased vehicle is captured opposite Westlands bus terminal. Terminus driving along Oyakiwe to an CBD.
The late Jacob Juma, before his death, mentioned the Deputy President of the Republic of Kenya, William Samoei Ruto. Have you summoned the Deputy President of the Republic of Kenya?
Allow me to answer that question. Okay.
Why is it difficult for you to tell us whether you have summoned the Deputy President or not, and it is easy for you to tell us that you have spoken to some of the people who you mentioned in the investigations? Have you summoned the Deputy President of the Republic of Kenya?
The ones that will be summoned will be seeing the men. With someone, he will see that we are stumbling or we do his statement. In any case, it's not all of the witnesses. Some have requested that you go to the offices. We have done that. Until such a point I will determine that so-and-so XYZ is a suspect, that becomes a totally different story altogether.
Are you looking at the case of the Twitter? The tweets that Jacob Juma tweeted?
On the daily, I'll just respond to that question.
From the onset, KTN's Crime and Investigations Desk established facts that suggested that Jacob Juma met his death not at the scene where his bullet-riddled body was discovered, but elsewhere. Tonight, the lead is going the extra mile of detailing the last 12 hours of the slain businessman. Apart from meeting his lawyer, going for lunch with his friends and sending his clothes for laundry, Juma's last 6 hours have been captured by the lead. A period the police have either deliberately not cared to document or have been unable to accurately piece together. The current director of Criminal Investigations Department, Dego Muhoro, called a press conference to give an account of Juma's last 3 hours, but his version of events has raised more questions than answers. The police account goes that Jacob Juma's movements 3 hours before his death started from Westlands and ended up somewhere near Yaya Center. The Directorate of Investigations can only account for Juma's last 45 minutes. According to the police, surveillance software stationed at the Jogoo House Command Center, fitted with automated number plate recognition cameras and video clips from CCTV cameras mounted in most parts of the city, captured Jacob Juma's movements. The Director of Criminal Investigations Department says Jacob Juma was first seen at the Westlands bus terminus at 7:34 p.m. that fateful night.
With the deceased on the driver's seat and a passenger on the passenger seat. At 19:36 hours, the deceased is captured along Moyakiwe near Villa Rosa, Nairobi, driving towards Uhuru Highway. At 19:38, he is captured at Kenyatta Uhuru Highway near Ministry of Tourism, driving along Uhuru Highway towards Mombasa Road. And at this time, we have a passenger on the passenger driver seat. At 19:53, he is captured at Uhuru Highway and near the Central Park, along Uhuru Highway towards Wayakiwe. At 19:55, he is captured again at Nyerere Road near the Children's Traffic Park, along Nyerere Road towards Kenyatta Avenue. And in this time, he is all alone from the time he is captured near the Central Park.
Essentially, what Ndego Muoro was telling the media was Jacob Juma was on Wayakiwe, less than 200 meters away
from the Nyaya House roundabout. Muhoro does not explain how in 2 minutes Jacob Juma managed to drive all the way to Nyaya House roundabout, drive back all the way to University Way roundabout onto Yaya Center. The police account also doesn't say if Juma used the processional way or drove down to take a left turn into Lenana Road before reaching Yaya Center. The Criminal Investigations Department statement does not mention details of other vehicles which could have been trailing Jacob Juma or were near his motor vehicle the night he was gunned down.
Among them was a lady whom we believe to have been and the one captured on CCTV footage together with the deceased in his motor vehicle. We managed to trail the lady who recorded a statement and indicated that the deceased dropped her around Trattoria around 8 that evening.
But Muhoro was at pains to explain how the same cameras failed to capture the details of the woman being dropped off by Jacob Juma outside the Trattoria restaurant. The leaders now established there are more than 7 CCTV cameras outside the Trattoria restaurant that should have captured the woman's side of the story, but that is missing. That is the police version of Juma's last 30 minutes, but is that what really happened on that night? Tonight, the lead has some answers. The lead captures Jacob Juma's last hours before his death from 10:54 a.m. in the morning after he left his current home. Juma seen here driving alone is captured by CCTV cameras on the southern bypass on Langata Road toward the Central Business District. 11 minutes later, CCTV cameras captures Jacob Juma's dark blue motor vehicle. 30 minutes later, Juma is seen near Bunyala Road roundabout, again still driving alone, but this time on phone. It is not clear who Juma was speaking to. At exactly 3:03 on the afternoon of that fateful Thursday, Juma is captured on Wayaki Way towards Westlands roundabout. It was 10 minutes later that Juma made his way into his penthouse in Parklands. The CCTV images obtained by the lead are the only ones available in the security system. The rest of the images that could place Jacob Juma in various locations on the day he died are missing. No one knows under whose instructions they were destroyed or confiscated. At 3:15 p.m. on Thursday afternoon, Jacob Juma made his way into his penthouse. The last time he did so, after staying here for a straight 7 years.
At 2:14 hours, he was captured at Agus Kothek Road, along Agus Kothek Road, near his air center, Twans Ole Odume Road. The last that we've captured of him on video is at 2:20:07 along Lenana Road.
But that statement could not be further from what really happened. Images available to the lead show that Jacob Juma was not making his way to Oledume Road and later joined Ngong Road, but was actually heading back to Yaya Center from Oledume Road. Those who know Jacob Juma say he was a stickler of roads. He preferred using Langata Road and always insisted driving in traffic in case he was ambushed by would-be attackers. Juma's blue motor vehicle rolled into these gates of Rose's apartments along Brookside Avenue at 3:15 on the Thursday was killed.
Kutoka katoka saa moja na 45. Sasa wale alimutoa na askari wa usiku na mimi mchana mimi ndo nilimuingiza. Mimi kufunga kasi kuenda mimi nikawaacha chako kwa hapo. Kabla mtu yote hajakuja kumtembelea.
The Dega told the lead Juma was driving himself when he showed up at the apartment. The guard says Juma mostly spent his afternoon on the second floor apartment and usually left at about 9:15 p.m. for his current home. Juma would watch the 7 o'clock bulletin to the end, watch the first part of the 9 o'clock news before leaving for his current home. A A close friend of Jacob Juma's told the lead Juma wouldn't leave his penthouse before that time unless he was going to meet a person who was meeting for the first time. Juma will host, among other people, Nairobi top lawyer Ahmed Nasir, a cabinet secretary, and even a member of parliament from Bungoma County. The guard here told us his house was a home and an office complete with a house help. At exactly 6:27 p.m. that Thursday evening, a lady was dropped outside the Roses apartment. She told the night guard she was here to see Jacob Juma, the occupant of house number 9. Armed with the car registration number of the motor vehicle that dropped the lady, the lead tracked down the taxi and its owner.
At some point around 5 in the evening, he took off his phone. The phone was put again on around 8. And this we can pick from the analysis that you're doing. So that is still an area that we need to still work around.
Juma can pick your sim up, if you are after
11.
Yeah, 11? Yeah, 5:11. Kununuza maliniko, akaniambia, enda sarit, you bring somebody. You know, by the time Jijia nilipatia namba yake, I called the lady. She told me I was stuck in traffic, tao, I had to wait.
Akakunja, malikuwa nimepak gari hapo sari, itakaingia ndani. This is the time assumption alinipigia.
601.
Kama amefika sarit. Kama ambia nimepak mali fulani, kuja kwa gari. This is the number.
No one else went into Juma's apartment until 45 minutes past 7 p.m. that night, when Juma left the apartment, this time in the company of a lady.
Juma left the apartment in the company of a lady.
Ali said, "Man, enda apa mago kumbi."
Since we have major kita kada wa enda kwa. Apa ni penya ni semua? Zataba kita kumbi kan? Kuzanga kwa la semua mapa mfunguli. Kabla hujamfungulia, wewe umeangalia hii. Hii ni sheria yake. Kabla hujamfungulia, lazima umeangalia nje.
For the first time, the lead can reveal the identity of the woman last seen with Jacob Juma, and we have a recorded telephone conversation of the woman the morning after Jacob Juma was gunned down. It is not clear what transpired between 7:45 p.m. and 9:30 p.m. when Jacob Juma's body was discovered near Lenana area on Gong Road. But a telephone conversation between Juma's taxi driver and the lady paints a picture of a person who was unsettled.
Kitu 8. Abiminiwa tangapi?
Mimi nasikia kwa nilisikia kwa radio kwanza kitu 7.
Kwa nimesikia pia mimi sehemu kikubwa cho
before 7. Alafu ndo mtu mwingine akanipigia simu. Kuniuliza story za Juma, ndio akaniambia bwana angalia KTN, naona kuna story na inasema Juma eti Juma ameuliwa.
Lakini acha nikuulize.
Eh.
Sasa uko mnaambia gari yake ni bulletproof.
Alikuwa amekwambia pia wewe?
Hadi akanionyesha.
Unajua, at least unajua ule watu wale watu walikuwa na unajua sasa hii wakitaka kujua what happened. Wanataka wale watu walikuwa na the most recently.
Wewe unajua mtani maliza.
Eh?
Sisi tuna shida gani?
Takumaliza?
Eh.
Kwa nini?
Sasa hiyo ni shida gani?
Nani atakumaliza?
Yani for him kabisa ndio.
You will just tell them what you know.
Lakini kabisa meuniwa ama tu.
Uko ofisi hapa kuna TV?
Hakuna. Unajua mimi nimesikia kwa radio kwa news.
Cheryl Gitonga claims she was dropped right in the Central Business District 5 minutes after leaving Rose's apartment. In 12 minutes, she was already at her house in South B. The Thursday evening Jacob Juma was killed, it had rained. There was a traffic snarl-up along Wayaki Way from Westlands.
KTN, kwa headlines in Iran, sahi, hapa news alert, controversial businessman Juma, Jacob Juma shot dead. It's running.
Nakwana mishutua, they say put kari yake ni bulletproof.
Hakuna kito yeze kanangi bana, bulletproof kwa ni zwot, it's just an man-made.
Guy, jenga mishutu kengia ndani.
Weskia,
mishutu kengia ndani. Ngeuliwa na yeye.
Sasa lakini sasa unajua wapo muulia town.
Eh.
Aliuliwa akienda kwake huko Karen, huko unene. Huko huko Lenana.
Eh.
Sasa wewe ukipigiwa simu na watu kufanya investigation au wakukuinterrogate, you just tell them what you know. Because I'm sure even mimi pengine watanipigia simu. Kabla na mimi najua nilikuwa na yeye last.
Ndio nasema last na mimi. Eh.
Sasa kwa nyumba hapo.
It is not clear how Jacob Juma could manage to beat the traffic and be in town 10 minutes to 8 p.m. that night. If Juma was to leave the CBD at 8 p.m. for Karen, he would have arrived home 30 minutes later.
Apo town, apo, unona apo karibu na Trattoria, unajua Trattoria?
Trattoria.
Apo, yali kutubishia apo. Na ilikuwa exactly saa ngapi? Like 10 minutes to 8.
Okay, kitu kama 7:50.
Hapo. By 8:12, nilikuwa kwa nyumba. By 8:12.
By 8:12 ulikuwa kwa nyumba?
Wewe ulisema unaishi na unaishi hiyo side ya South B.
South B.
Even the police version that Juma took approximately 12 minutes between Utalii House and the Kenyatta Avenue roundabout contradicts Cheryl Gitonga's story that she was dropped off in town by Juma. But even the police version still leaves even more questions begging. Where was Juma between 8 p.m. when he dropped Cheryl Gitonga in the CBD and 9:30 p.m. when he was killed? The lead has information that at 8:20 p.m. that night, Juma had called a friend and told him he had just spoken to a foreign envoy in Nairobi and was in the process of texting details of a corruption dossier he was working on. The friend told his family that Juma had secured an appointment with the foreign envoy. What is unusual, Juma told the friend he was still at his apartment when he was making a call. Could it be the lady was not dropped in the central business district as she had alleged, or Juma was not in his penthouse along Brookside Drive at 8:20 p.m. as he had told his friend? A conversation between Cheryl Gitonga and the taxi driver raises questions. The lady, who says she was not familiar with the Westlands area, told the taxi driver that it was her first time to meet the slain businessman. Police insist Jacob Juma was with the lady friend during the day before they agreed to meet later that evening.
Tusasa mimi niko na wazazi wangu ni wakali.
Watoto?
Wazazi.
Oh, wazazi wako? Wani bado unaishi na waparen?
Imagine.
Sina
kwa mimi niko na stress.
Uwe bado ni mtoto wa mama? Anyway, maisha ni hivo. Lakini nilikuwa nataka tu confirm kutoka kwako ni wape exactly ulimwacha tao.
Ni hapo.
Hapo tena na
confirm, kwani pia wewe unafanya investigation
ya nini?
The leaders learned that the police officers investigating Juma's murder are yet to trace Jacob Juma's last movements through the central business district, if indeed Juma dropped the woman friend in town, or traced her last moments through the central business district.
All the way from Oyaki Way into town, you can clearly see Jacob Juma as an occupant of his car. But you're telling us you lose him at some point with the female passenger, and then the female passenger tells you She was dropped outside Trattoria. There are cameras there, there are city council cameras there. There are cameras, I've told you, seven of them near Trattoria area. What are they telling you? That you've not told
me. I've stated very clearly, and I get my point as a rigor, that not all cameras are working in town. They might have some reasons for not working. What you have picked so far, and you're not done as yet, you're still looking at all the cameras that are in certain positions, which I believe to have been the route that was taken by the deceased. So as at that point, I can say that we haven't seen anything. We haven't looked at those cameras. We're going to be looking at them.
A close friend of Juma says he rarely carried anyone in his car, and if anyone came visiting him, a taxi driver will drop and later pick up his guests every time they came visiting. The lead traveled to the scene of the killing, and for the first time, it has established that Jacob Juma was not killed inside his car, but was placed there by his killers and his vehicle rolled to the side of the road. A perfect crime scene, complete with a convincing narrative. It is now emerging that Juma was shot in a clinical way by his killers in a struggle that has baffled his family and relatives, who attended his autopsy at the Lee Findro home 3 days after he was gunned down. Juma's neck had a gauze, a woven cloth normally used for dressing wounds or stopping bleeding. The same gauze was also on his right hand, raising eyebrows. Who is this who stopped to help out Juma at the scene of the shooting? If he was abducted and shot, who is this who put on his neck a gauze? Was the cloth meant to stop him from bleeding after shooting him, or did his killers change their mind about finishing him off and instead try to save him from bleeding to death? An autopsy report indicates that his right hand was shot at several times with a high velocity gun, and this was done at close range. The gunshot damaged one of his major arteries in what a doctor says will have led to massive bleeding and death seconds later. Guards at a construction site less than 1,000 meters away from where Juma was killed told the lead there was no unusual sound that aroused their suspicion. Juma's car had more than 7 bullet holes from what appears as an AK-47 rifle inflicted gunfire. If Juma's car was shot at 7 times, chances are the guards who had the first 3 loud sounds will have heard the rest.
A 2 persons approached a police officer who was on duty at the China Road and Bridge construction. They informed him that they had seen a motor vehicle which had shattered windows at the interchange of the Southern Bypass off Gong Road. And on receiving this information, this officer with 2 other officers proceeded to the scene.
The story by the CID director contradicts one given by his own police officer, who documented coming across the vehicle and informing current police station. The guards at the construction site have told the lead they were alone that night and there was no police officer manning the site at the time. Again, it is not clear which site the criminal investigations director refers to in his report. The lead caught up with the man who was called by the police to tow away Juma's car from the scene of the killing. It is surprising that not a single motorist has told the police that he came across a motor vehicle off the busy Mombasa Road turnoff until a police officer allegedly informed Karen police station about the shooting incident. Juma's vehicle was automatic. His car had not rammed into a stationary object to suddenly go off. Who switched off his car?
Gari ilikuwa ina run engine ama hivi.
Injini ilikuwa imezima lakini mataa bado zilikuwa zimewaka.
Okay. Injini ilikuwa imezima kabisa.
Si na siku sikia injini ikiguruma. Na mkiwa ime kali kwa ile shaft. Kwa drive na headlight zilikuwa zimewaka on.
The wipers on his car were up, an indication that it could have been raining at the time. The man who towed away Jacob Juma's car says he entered the vehicle, engaged the nitro gear, but also noticed something unusual about the scene of Juma's murder.
Mwili ilikuwa ndani. Ilikuwa na mwili ndani ya gari. Ndani ya gari. Then tukaambiwa tukaekae hapo, wakafanya mambo zao, wakatoa mwili na barua zingine. Alafu wakatuambia tupite gari.
Kulikuwa na damu kwa steering?
Kulikuwa na damu tu kwa viti. Yeah, kwa viti kulikuwa na damu.
Steering?
Siwezi kukumbuka.
Indeed, the car had blood stains and Juma's seed had minimal blood, raising more questions about how he died and where exactly he died. Juma's body was moved to Karen police station and his body ferried there in a police Land Cruiser. It wasn't until 6 hours later that police booked his body at the city mortuary. This was at about 1:57 a.m. on that Friday morning. What were the police doing with Jacob Juma's body for that long? An analysis of the post-mortem report on Jacob Juma's body indicates he was shot several times in the right hand. Injuries consistent with close-range shooting. He had one bullet on the right and left hand side of his neck that entered his body through an angle that ruptured his lungs. The bullet wounds to his neck were shot from a distance. Two bullet holes on the center of his chest were the closest to hit the businessman. Jacob Juma was a licensed firearm holder, but police are yet to say if he was armed at the time of the shooting and have not questioned his family about the whereabouts of Juma's gun. It is now emerging that police somehow left out details of CCTV footage of Jacob Juma leaving Yaya Center for his current home. If Juma was last seen at 8:14 p.m. on the night he was killed, did it take him 1 hour 30 minutes to the scene where he was killed? Where was Jacob Juma between 8 p.m. and 9:30 p.m. when he was gunned down? Then there is the missing tweets of Jacob Juma on his Twitter handle. Tweets the lead has, but one is appears Jacob Juma's deleting from his grave. Juma had mentioned powerful individuals allegedly being behind the looting of 100 billion shillings, part of the Eurobond proceeds, even though he had not provided any evidence of his claims. Police are yet to explain what Jacob Juma's killers were doing with his mobile phones for 1 hour before leaving them at the scene of his shooting. The lead now knows that Juma's killers had all the time to go through his mobile phone messages and those contained in his WhatsApp application for more than 1 hour before dumping his body along Lenana area on the night he was killed. If you're driving from Wayaki Way on to the University Way roundabout, Nyerere Road, Yaya Center, and later on this road, Oledume Road, there are at least 5 security cameras that should have captured the last movements of Jacob Juma. According to the police, Jacob Juma was captured on this road exiting Tungong Road, but according to the lead, Jacob Juma was heading back to Yaya Center. Notice, for instance, the time on the CCTV cameras on the junction of Yaya Center and Oledume Road, 30 minutes before Jacob Juma's motor vehicle passed here. The cameras were up and working. The lead traveled on the same road Jacob Juma is alleged to have traveled on the night he was killed. For instance, if Juma used Nyerere Road before joining the procession away, CCTV cameras must have captured his movements all the way to Oledume Road and later on Tungong Road. This will give the police officers a clear picture of the killers of Jacob Juma, who they were, and how far they trailed him. CCTV cameras in the city are strategically located on the highways, turnoffs, and acceleration lanes, making it virtually impossible for a motorist to hide away from the big brother. How did the camera somehow manage to avoid capturing Juma's movement on the night he died? From this spot,
on to Ngong Road and later to the scene where Jacob Juma was killed, there are no security cameras. If his killers had planned to have him killed and have him waylaid, then this would have been a perfect blind spot to carry out their murder. But according to Juma's family and friends, he rarely used Ngong Road.
We wish to ask the minister for security on Kayseri and the Inspector General of Police, Mr. Burnett, to provide us with the following. Number one, the CCTV footage of Jacob's car tracked to Ngong Road on the night of Thursday, May the 5th. Number two, the mobile telephone data detailing the various mobile operator locator masks Jacob's phone traveled through on the night of May 5th and morning of May 6th.
Juma's killers must have left their mobile data at the scene of his killing on the night they shot him dead. Solid evidence for the police to find the murderers. And so it remains a mystery that 2 weeks after the gruesome killing, there is still no word on just who extinguished the businessman on that Thursday night. Denson Sarigo, the lead, KTN News.